Do you know something of the love of God? Do you understand what that song means and says and speaks about? Then it should just create something to well up inside of you. I mean, it should do one of two things. And I've experienced both at different times. Sometimes it just wells up a worship inside of you that you can't set still. And other times it just brings you to a reverent state of brokenness. Have you experienced? Do you know what I'm talking about? That's what the love of God should do to us. The love of God should drive us to our knees. It should bring us to the cross. It should send us to the streets. It should cause something in our mouth to speak of this one we love so much. I pray that's your testimony this morning. I pray that's what you know in your heart and what you see in your life to be true. But if not, don't leave today without it. Don't leave today without the love of Jesus in your life. Because if you do, what you leave with is the wrath of God on your life. And the two are totally at odds. Turn with me, please, to Acts chapter 5. And as you turn to Acts chapter 5, I want to point out a couple that we love dearly sitting in the back of our church that we have been missing and missing deeply. Just wave at them. Please don't get up and go hug their necks or anything of that nature, but Richard and Tammy McMasters are back there. No. They slipped in a little late and they're going to leave a little early. Has nothing to do with you all. They want to be among us, but the doctor says they need to still be careful. Still be careful. And so, but what a privilege to have our family together. Acts chapter 5, verses 12 through 16, please, is where we'll be. And we'll focus on the first three verses and probably not get to the others, but there's a reason for that. So let's read this with me, please. The title of this message is Great Fear Came Upon All the Church. Acts chapter 5, verses 12 through 16. And it says this, "And through the hands of the apostles, many signs and wonders were done among the people, and they were all with one accord on Solomon's porch. Yet none of the rest dared join them, but the people esteemed them highly. And the believers were increasingly added to the Lord in multitudes of both men and women, so that they were brought the sick out into the streets and laid them on their beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter might pass over them and fall on some of them. Also a multitude gathered from the surrounding cities of Jerusalem, bringing sick people and those who were tormented by unclean spirits, and they were all healed." Would you pray with me, please? Fathers, we are in your house and pleased to be here. Father, excited even in a reverential way to be here in your house. Father, I pray that you would open this scripture to our hearts. Father, use your word as only your word can to penetrate deep into our spirits and to make us to be more like your son. Father, to kill our flesh and to revive our spirit. Father, to do a sanctifying work in us that makes us to look more like your son every day. Father, that we would have something to sing about, that we would know experientially what your love is. Father, that it would move us, that it would move us to speak of you often, to pray to you unceasingly. Father, we love you. I praise you for this word. I praise you for your son and the truth that we find in it. In his name we pray. Amen. If you remember last week, we preached about this Acts chapter 5, 1 through 11, and we saw in there this story of these two people, Ananias and Sapphira. And we saw that they lied to the Holy Spirit. They lied to the Holy Spirit about the price of their own property. They just made it up to make it seem like they had done more for the Lord in order to gain or to garnish an attaboy or a praise from other people, and they were killed for it. Ananias and Sapphira, in the middle of a revival taking place in the church, were killed for lying to the Holy Spirit. But remember why they died, and remember who it was that killed them. Peter did not kill them. They did not die because they were just in the wrong place at the wrong time, heart attack or some other weird thing. They died because they lied to the Holy Spirit, and they died by the hand of God himself. That should shock some of us. Some of us said, what? This is not very churchy. I've never experienced that in church before. We've sung some songs, we've read some scriptures, but I've never seen a husband and a wife die for lying to the Holy Spirit. You should be thankful. You should say, praise you, Lord, for not killing me when I've come to church with sin in my life, or when I've lied against the Holy Spirit, even in the midst of this, or even outside on the streets? What's the difference in the church or outside of the church? We are the church. So here you see these two people. They lied to the Holy Spirit, and God himself caused Ananias and Sapphira to breathe their last. That's what the scripture says. Verse 11. They lied stealing glory from the Godhead Trinity. They lied in the Holy Spirit. This actually happened. This is historical information, not just a neat little thing that somebody tossed into an unusually fun story to get your attention or to make sure that you're awake. This is actually what happened. They lied and they died for it. What did they try to accomplish? They wanted to look better. They wanted to look. Hear this phrase, because I think it should apply. It should hit you a little bit. Maybe a kidney punch or sucker punch to the face, whichever applies, I don't care. They wanted to look better than they're willing to live. They wanted to appear holier than they were actually willing to live in their daily life. Church, is that you? Man, is that me? Is that your pastor? Do I desire to look holier than I am actually willing to strive to live? God forbid. That's a shame on Jesus' face. That is an insult to him, if to act better than I actually am. They were doing this, and it was at God's expense. They were stealing what can only be given to God, and that's his glory. They were stealing something from the Lord that should have been his. It was his glory. Because if they sold their property, if they gave it for a certain price, and if they said, Lord, use it as you please, no one should have even known about it. It should have been a secret thing within their heart, all for the glory of God, so that he could use it as he pleases. But they did not do that. They broke the second commandment. They broke the sixth. They broke the ninth. They broke the tenth. They broke all of the Ten Commandments in lying to the Holy Spirit and stealing and being idolatry and all these other things that they coveted, the glory that God should only receive. Listen to this verse. This is Hebrews 10:30. We read part of it last week. I want to read 10:30 and 31. So Hebrews, write it down next to your Bible. Get a piece of paper. There's some around you if you would. If you expect something from God, have a pen in your hand. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 30 and 31 says this, "For we know him who said," that's capital H-I-M, "we know him who said, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord. And again, the Lord will judge his people." Verse 31, "It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God." Believe me, this entire church, after Ananias and Sapphira had lied to the Holy Spirit, they knew this scripture to be true. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. It says the Lord will judge his people. It's speaking to us, church. It's talking about our lives. The holiness or the absence of holiness in it. He will judge us. They were acting the part of a hypocrite. Ananias and Sapphira, led by the father, by the way, led by the husband. The wife was given a chance in front of Peter to say the truth. She did not. So she also suffered the penalty of death. But the husband led in the wrong path, and they died for it. They wanted the praise of men rather than the praise of God. In the midst of this great revival, now just remember what has just happened over the last month or 3 weeks or so, since the day of Pentecost. Remember the preaching and the salvation stories. 8,000 people plus had come to Christ. This is a great revival. This is a great movement. You could just imagine the experience similar to camp or to a mission trip when you come home. You feel this great exaltation, this wonder, this amazement. And then a man walks into church that morning, tells a lie against the Holy Spirit, and drops dead. You would think that's a bit of a downer, wouldn't you? You would think, boy, just messed up a good revival. The evangelist or the preacher might say, wow, we had something going. Too bad now. I guess we better bury this dude. Something amazing happened. God walked into this experience. They lied to the Holy Spirit, and two people died in a church service. It was at this moment, though, that the greatest part happened. Because until then, the glory of God had been seen. The praise, the worship, the mercy, the grace had been seen. But now, what enters to the church, what enters in is what? The fear. The fear of God. And church, if you do not fear God, you do not know God. We talk way too much about the love of God. I mean, can you speak too much about the love of God? No, but in comparison to never speaking of this fear, the fear of a holy and just God, he's 100% and 100% of each. He is not 50-50. He's not, well, on Sunday he's love and on Saturday night he's wrath. No, he is all wrath and he is all love, all at the exact same time. So here in the midst, we see this great fear come upon the entire church. An awakening of who God is. Now, as an illustration, I want to tell you about some fears that we have in our world. Some fears that some of you in here may even experience. I don't know. I hope you do not, because here they are. Do you know there is a fear of bathing, young men, that went to camp? It's called ablutophobia. The fear of bathing. People around you fear something if you have the fear of bathing. There's a fear of dirt, mesophobia. Sounds funny, right? Mesophobia. Mesophobia. It's a fear of dirt. That would be terrible. I love dirt. Dirt's a wonderful thing. How about this one? A fear of vegetables. Marshall? Oh, did I say that out loud? That's a lanchanophobia, the fear of vegetables. You fear green beans or corn, I don't know. Maybe VeggieTales traumatized you as a child. Christophobia. It's not the fear of Christ, it's the fear of the color orange. Anybody? Billy, I know that's not you. The fear, not just the hatred, but the fear of orange. You fear it. How about this one, acrophobia? Anybody know what that is? No, not arachnophobia. Acrophobia. The fear of heights. The fear of heights. We, many of us, have this dreaded fear of heights, and then there's the fear of orange, there's the fear of dirt, the fear of vegetables, and then the fear of bathing. There are many fears that we have. We fear a lot of things. But do you know who we should fear? We should fear God. Yes, the God of creation. Yes, the God that sent His Son to die on a cross to save our sins. We should fear Him in an awe and a reverential way that causes us to be quiet and to be still. This is what God should create in us. Not a fear of irrational things. Not a fear that you need drugs or medication to overcome so that you can be around vegetables. I mean a fear of God that you cannot get over. You should not get over it. It should cause you to love Him and to know Him greater and to desire to know Him more. Verse 11 said this in that chapter 5. We read it last week, and here's what it said. So great fear came upon all the church and upon all those who heard these things. Not just a little fear. A great fear. Because this was church folks, people. Ananias and Sapphira, they were church people. Probably prominent, well-known church people who ended up dead on that Sabbath day. Psalms 51 verse 6 says this. Psalms 51, verse 6 says, Behold, you, this is speaking about the Lord, behold, you desire truth in the inwardmost parts. And in the hidden part, you will make me to know wisdom. God does not desire us to be the hypocrite and to stand up on Sunday morning and to raise our hands and to worship Him and then as soon as church is over, go out and live our life the way we choose. That's lying to the Holy Spirit. That's a hypocrite. And it destroys you, it destroys your witness, and it destroys your children if they're watching or your friends and neighbors if they see it, and they do. They do see it. They know it to be true. He desires us in the inwardmost parts to love Him and to fear Him. So this time that we're getting to, this moment in this history of the book of Acts, it's not a moment of chaos. It's not disorder. It's not running around jumping, hooping, and hollering and doing laps around the church. It's not what it is. It's a reverential, calm, awe-filled fear that they're experiencing. Were there questions about what had just happened? These two people were carried out and buried in the same day within 3 hours of one another. Were there questions? Oh, yeah, I'm sure. Are there still questions? Yeah, I would still have questions. I hope to have answers someday, but if I don't, it's a mystery. There are and there were questions, but let me ask you this. Should anyone feel pity? Should we pity Ananias and Sapphira? No. Ananias chose willingly to lie to the Holy Spirit. I don't pity him. We should not pity him. Should we show or feel anger towards God for killing them? No. Not a bit. Does God need a PR man to clean this up? Does he need somebody to come in and make, you know, illustrations? Well, you know, he wasn't feeling well that day, or he was had been scared of vegetables all of his life and had never eaten well. Is there something that God needed somebody to come in and fix for him? Not a bit. God did exactly what he wanted to do. There is no apology. There is no repentance needed. He did not need anyone to apologize, and he will never need anyone to apologize for anything God has ever done from the beginning of creation, from before creation until the end. God will ask no repentance. He will ask no apology of anyone. He is God. He will not apologize for this day in history, nor on that great and final day of judgment. Do you know there will be a great and final day of judgment when all of those will be judged and sentenced to either heaven or hell? When he will say to those who have rejected him that awful verse of Matthew 7, verse 23. Do you know what it says? Matthew 7, 23. Probably the most fear-filling verses in all of Scripture. Matthew 7, 23. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Those who had done miracles and had done amazing things and had prophesied, said, Lord, Lord, we've done all these things for you. He said, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Ananias and Sapphira, that's who we're talking about. Depart. You've lied to the Holy Spirit. You sinned and you deserve death. He will not have to apologize for any of this. When God judges man and casts all of them who reject him into hell, he will not stand up and wait to be answering for it. As a matter of fact, all of heaven, hear this, all of heaven will stand and rejoice because he has rid the earth of that sinner. That's the fear of God. That's the biblical knowledge of who God is. It won't be like, oh man, I lost that one. Man, I wish I could have gotten him to heaven. All of heaven, the angels, the saints of old, the 24 sitting on the thrones that we learned about in Sunday school this morning, they will stand and rejoice saying, praise God for ridding the earth of that sinner. That's the God we serve in the Scripture. That's the God we see him. There is no sadness in heaven. There's only righteous and perfect judgment, God's judgment. Verse 12 goes on, it says, through the hands of the apostles, many signs were done among the people. Now, I take that literal, through the hands of the apostles. There were many signs and wonders done. Matter of fact, it's going to go on to explain these further. Next week, we'll be talking about it. But it's through the hands of the apostles. I do not believe it was this apostolic moment when all of the church was just walking around and touching people and they were healed and raising people from the dead and having demons passed out. It was through the hands of the apostles. There was nothing chaotic about this. This was ordered. God is the God of order. He is not a God of chaos. So this is well ordered. This is a chain of events that's taking place according to God's perfect timing. And I want you to remember why these miracles were done. Now, there's a movement today that says miracles are needed, and they are, but they're needed because the people should be blessed by God. Like, if you know God, you should be blessed by God. If you know God, you should be rich, you should be wealthy, you should live forever. That's kind of what a large group of some evangelicals are preaching. The blessings of God. It's a name it and claim it kind of a ministry. That's not what we see here. What was the reason for the signs and the miracles and the wonders? The reason was to give God glory, first of all, for the glory of God, to the glory of God, and for the gospel being portrayed and being told over and over and over for people to hearing it. For the glory of God, and so that the gospel could be spoken of broadly, so that people would hear it. These are the two reasons. The gospel is the main event here, not the signs and wonders. What's the greatest miracle to ever be performed on the earth? Who knows the answer? The greatest miracle ever. The salvation of one single soul. Greater than all of creation, greater than the judgment of all those who will be condemned, salvation of one single soul is the greatest miracle of all. These are the miracles, these are the signs and the wonders, these are all the reasons of this new church. This is not for entertainment. It's not to prop up the church and to make them look better. It is for the gospel to be presented and for people to hear about their sin and their need for the Savior. The healing that they're talking about is less about physical and more about spiritual. It's an eternal conversation that they're having. Who cares about the physical? If you're healed from whatever it is, you know you're going to get sick again, right? If you're raised from the dead, what's going to happen? You're going to die. You just get the privilege of dying twice. That happened in Scripture at different times. Jesus did not come to this earth to heal you from anything, whatever it might be. He came to this earth to forgive your sins, to heal you from sin, but not from anything physical. He came to heal you from spiritual sin. Do not be distracted by the physical attributes and these things that are being done. It's just to bring God glory and to bring reality to the gospel presentation. This is the reason Jesus came. This is the reason that he died on the cross. He died so that we could be free from sin, to be free from the debt of sin, and to be free from the omission of sin. You guys know that we're not just saved from our sin, we're saved from sinning. We often don't realize this. We're like, well, we can't live a perfect life, and you're true, you're right in that, but we should desire to. Your life today should look better than yesterday. Those that love the Lord desire to keep his commandments. That's what he's saying here. We should be free from the debt of sin. We are. We should be free from the slavery to sin. To be free from hell that we deserve and the wrath of God that we also should experience. The greatest miracle is salvation of a soul. But too often we're more interested in the healing, the speaking, the doing of miraculous acts. We can't see the salvation of a soul, can you? Can you see when a person's saved? You can sometimes see the effects of salvation, but you cannot see their heart change. Only God can. Only that person and God, and really only God, knows if there's been a change in that heart. But you can see the effects of it. This is what the church is looking at, and this is what they're seeing. They're seeing that man have been changed. Men and women are coming in a multitude. It says God would not allow his revival or his church to slip into some kind of a man-centered gospel. We will not focus on the miracles and on the signs and wonders. We'll focus on the gospel presentation. That was the purpose of them. He would keep it true, and he would keep it holy, and he would keep it right, and he would keep it godly. And why? And how do we know that's true? How do we know that God would not allow his gospel to be manipulated? Because there's two dead people sitting in church that Sunday morning. Because the fear of God was brought down on the church. It wasn't just a I want to come and get cured of whatever disease I have. It was that you need to come and you need to find out about the sin, the disease of sin, and the ultimate consequence of hell. This is not a man-centered gospel. This is a Christ-centered gospel. So he brought this godly fear upon the church. Remember who did it. Remember who brought the godly fear. Remember what we need. And I think often, too often, we don't experience it. I think our lives are weak. My own life, let's point it towards me. My own life is weak in my ability to live Christ-likeness because I don't fear God enough. Can you look in your own life and answer the question the very same? Can you say honestly that you either do or do not fear God as you should? Because it will come out in your day-to-day life. You will know. People will know around you if you fear the Lord. He brought a godly fear upon this church. Fear within and fear without. And you might be tempted to feel that this judgment was a disruption from the revival, but it was not. It was the revival. This is what is going to start and instigate a movement that is going to spread throughout the world. Verse 14 says this. You think it might have paused it or thrown some cold water on it. Verse 14 says, believers were increasingly added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women. This is after the fear. This is after the fear of God was brought down on them and they saw him as he should be. It reminded all the people, both inside and outside the church, of who was in charge. And it was not Peter. It was not John. It was not the apostles. God himself would keep this pure. Isaiah 42:8 says this. Isaiah 42:8, another verse you should write down and know. I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory I will not give to another, or my praise to carved images. The Lord will be praised, either by you now, and your knee bowing and your tongue confessing, or it will happen on the day of judgment. Which would you choose? Isaiah 42:8 says he will not share his glory with anybody. And then back to our text, Acts chapter 5, verse 13 says, yet none of the rest dared. Now this is an interesting verse. It says, yet none of the rest dared join them, but the people highly esteemed them. This is talking about those outside of the church. There were some that weren't saved. Many were, remember, 8,000 to the tune of 8,000 and others in Jerusalem. A great revival. But there are some that have not bent the knee. There are some who have not come. They've seen all this happen, but they won't come. It says, the rest dared not join them. They respected the apostles. They respected the church. They feared the physical of what had happened with Ananias and Sapphira. They felt the fear. But you know why they wouldn't come, in my opinion? Because they loved their sin. Think of it. They knew that if they came and they wanted to count themselves with the church and call themselves a Christian, if they came into church with sin in their life, what might happen? Death. Acts 2 on Ananias and Sapphira. So they feared that. They said, no, we're not going to do that. We're not going that far. I love my sin more than that Savior, and I will not come that far. I'll stand right back here and watch it happen. I'll enjoy it as a spectator would. But I'm not willing to get any closer because I know I feared. They feared God, but they were lost. They would not come to the point because they loved their sin. Church, people here today, do you love your sin more than the Savior? Is it keeping you from full obedience to a life totally given over to the authorship and to the authority of Christ? Because as I said many times, you cannot have both. You cannot be the ruler of your life and have Jesus as your Savior. There can only be one. So these people stood off at a distance and they just wanted to watch what was going on, enjoy the spectacle, but not be a part of it because they feared God. Andrew Murray, pastor from back in the day, he said this, "He who fears the Lord will fear nothing else." Do you know that to be true? He who fears the Lord in a biblical sense will fear nothing else. Who else would you fear? What else would you fear? You must have a proper order of this fear. It must be a biblical fear that places God above everything and anything else. If we fear anything above the Lord, it's because we truly don't know God and we don't fear Him. You must have a holy reverence and an awe of God. When you see God, when you think of God, what comes to mind? The Man Upstairs, Garth Brooks song? Sorry, now that's going to be bouncing around in most of your heads for the rest of the day. Do you just think of like your good old boy, your buddy? Or is there some awe and respect and fear when it comes to thinking about who this is? Psalms 2, verse 11. Psalms 2, verse 11 says, "Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling." Let me repeat that. Psalms 2, verse 11 says, "Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling." Now, what's in the middle of rejoice? What is the root word? Joy. Joy is the root of rejoice. What causes the joy? What causes joy to well up in our heart? A proper fear of God. Do you lack joy in your heart? Might possibly be because you do not fear God. You have no awe and respect and appreciation of His authority. So you have no fear and you have no joy. This lack of joy often causes a lot of other things in our lives. Anxiety. When you don't fear God, you fear everything else. So you fear what man might say about you, what Facebook might say about you. You fear what man might do to you, what they won't do for you. There's a lot of fears when we don't properly orientate who we should fear and how we should fear. So this morning, I'm going to ask you, I'm going to say, do you fear God? Just simple answer. Answer it in your own head. Do you fear God? Do you fear what He can and should do to you? I asked our young boys at camp this week, I asked them, I said, what would happen if you, I asked it in the form of a question. I said, if you were to follow God all of your days, serve Him and worship Him, and at the end of your life, He should send you to hell, would it have been worth it? They struggled with that question. To follow God all of my life, to live for Him, to do what He wants, to not do what I want, and then at the end of it, He sends me to hell? Some of them were honest, and they said, that's not fair. That's not fair. No, but it's biblical. I deserve hell, church. There is nothing in me that deserves heaven. I could serve God my entire life because He is worthy of my service and he could send me to hell at the end of it, and he would be just and he would be right to do so. Do you understand that? That's the fear that we should develop. That's the fear we should understand. Now, thankfully, there is a mercy and there is a grace that Jesus gave. There is an assurance in my heart. I know the Lord has forgiven me those sins. And I know that one day when I stand before God, do you know this? One day when I stand before God, I know that he will say, enter into my rest. I know it. Not because of what I've done. Not because of what I haven't done, moralists. But because of Jesus Christ and his blood alone that has forgiven me of my sins, though they are many. Do you know this Savior the same? Do you fear God enough to respect him, to awe him, to listen to him? Then this morning, I ask you this. What is he asking you to do? What is he commanding you to do? Because if you fear God, you must obey. Those who do not fear God will not obey. They could feel the conviction. They could feel the prick in their heart that says, don't do this, or go now and do this, and they can say no. If you can say no to God, it's because you do not fear him. This morning, we're going to have a time of invitation. We're going to sing a song, and we're going to spend our time just focusing on what God would call us to do. What is he asking you to do? Do you understand sin? Do you know you have a need for a Savior? Will you fear God biblically? Would you pray with me? Father, as we come to this moment in your invitation on your day, Lord, I pray that your word has been heard. I pray that the Holy Spirit has spoken clearly. And Father, that the fear is understood. Biblical fear is understood. Not in a way that would puff us up, Father, but in a way that would tear us down. Lord, let us feel it. Let us see it. Let us hear it. Let us be broken by our own sin. Father, I pray that if there be any here that are proudful and boastful of what they've done for you, that you would remind them of where the glory lies. Father, that we would not lie to the Holy Spirit, but that we would be honest with the God of creation who knows every thought, who has seen every deed, even done in secret. Lord, I pray for repentance, and I pray for your will to be perfectly done this morning. It's in your Son's name. Amen. Would you stand with me, please?